Yeah, it's great to see you all here tonight. For those of you who don't know me, I'm David Fitzpatrick. I'm the CEO and Scientific Director of the Max Planck Florida Institute for Neuroscience. And, you know, those of you who do know me know that I love being a scientist. And one of the things that I love about science is that it's a never-ending journey. Okay, there's no end to the questions we can ask. And even when we think we've answered a question, what we discover is we've actually opened the door to new ones, new questions that we hadn't known enough to ask, and new opportunities to follow our curiosity, to devise new methods that increase our understanding, that give us more insights into the wonders of the world around us that we couldn't have imagined. Now, great scientists have a passion for challenging the status quo. And this is the perfect descriptor of tonight's speaker, Max Planck scientist Dr. Jens Frahm, whose passion for curiosity-driven discovery has enabled one of the most important tools in medical diagnostics, magnetic resonance imaging, MRI. I'm sure you all are familiar with that. Without his innovative insights, MRI imaging, which has impacted the lives of hundreds of millions of patients, would have remained just a theoretical concept, not a groundbreaking technology that could actually be used to see inside the human body. And as you'll see tonight, he didn't stop there. He continues to redefine the standards of medical imaging, taking this to a whole new level with his latest invention, real-time MRI, or as I like to say, MRI in motion. Okay, now, the passion for challenging the status quo also defines our musical guest tonight, Michael Amonte. He spent decades developing his talent and refining his phenomenal tenor voice to deliver joy to audiences around the world. His many accolades include an Emmy nomination, a critically acclaimed PBS series, and a top spot on Billboard's chart for classical musical artists. So, we've got a program for you tonight that I think you will really enjoy. But before we get there, just take a moment for some acknowledgments. First, I'd like to acknowledge our Brain Trust donors and supporters. Through your support, scientists at Max Planck Florida have the resources to challenge the status quo of neuroscience, to try new things, to ask big questions. You empower us to always continue building upon our scientific discoveries, to push into unknown frontiers of understanding the brain. And we are truly grateful for your support. And thanks again to Jimmy and Becky Mayer for their generosity that makes it possible for us to bring music to our science. Thank you, Jimmy and Becky. And finally, we're also extremely thankful that we have a wonderful partnership with our host, the Benjamin School. Before I go on, I'd like to introduce Tom Reed, head of school for Benjamin. Tom?
Thank you, David. And on behalf of the Benjamin School, I welcome you all to Benjamin Hall. My title, head of school, actually has a lead to it. I am interim head of school. I'm here for a year to assist the school in transition from one permanent head to another. And I've been doing this for 7 years of the 40 plus, almost 50 years I have been in independent schools. And I want to share with you just a couple thoughts about independent schools that tie to Benjamin but are broader than that, that really are key factors in independent schools. Two factors. In all those years in schools and observing other independent schools, the good schools, all of them good schools, but the truly great schools are separated by a number of things, two of which are part of this evening. First and foremost, partnerships with other institutions. Every great school has partnerships with other institutions, whether it's an art museum or a science museum, directly with a university or college. Those partnerships are crucial to independent schools. Certainly, our partnership with the Institute is crucial to what we can offer our students. It increases dramatically those offerings, enriching and enhancing opportunities, giving students exposure to another level of academia and research, opening their eyes to the possibilities of what's out there ahead of them. And for that, we thank the Institute. We're really very grateful for this partnership. The other aspect of independent schools that is really important, and really a factor distinguishes the great schools, is that they are private schools with a public purpose. It cannot be just about the Benjamin School and the 1,000 students who attend this school. It has to be broader and deeper than that. Yesterday, I spoke at our National Honor Society induction ceremony and referenced a story I had been told about Nobel Peace Prize winners, some of whom, after they achieved the prize, really struggled with their work and their lives. They had worked so hard for the prize, their purpose was tied up in the prize, and once achieved, they struggled. What really matters is having a purpose greater than just that prize, or that achievement, that momentary award. That's what we talk to our children, our students about. We as an institution attempt to do the same, to have a purpose beyond just our students and our faculty, to serve a public purpose. This evening, and the opportunity to open this facility to the Institute and to all of you as our guests, is just a small part of that public purpose. Nonetheless, we're very proud of that and very proud that you are here in the Benjamin Hall on the Benjamin School campus. We certainly expect and hope the partnership with the Max Planck Institute will continue for many, many years, and there will be many more evenings like this evening. I hope you enjoy the program, and again, I thank you for being here. Thank you.
All right, well, thanks to Tom again for allowing us to share this fantastic venue. Now, on to tonight's program. Tonight's musical guest is tenor Michael Amante. Michael's been celebrated by audience and critics alike around the world. As I mentioned earlier, he received an Emmy nomination for his self-titled PBS television special. And in 2002, he was listed as the number one classical artist of the year in Billboard magazine's year-end review. Michael's stage appearances include lead roles in Puccini's Madame Butterfly and La Boheme, West Side Story, Jesus Christ Superstar, Grease, and Little Abner. Talk about variety there, amazing. More recently, he portrayed the lead role of the American in the musical Chess, for which he received outstanding reviews. He's appeared on national television and radio, as well as in front of capacity crowds of over 80,000 at Giants Stadium and other sports venues, Madison Square Garden, for example. His sold-out venues include Carnegie Hall, Lincoln Center, Hines Hall, and the nation's top performing arts centers, casinos, and luxury resorts. Now, Michael's artistry drew its highest praise from the legendary Luciano Pavarotti, who recognized Michael's unique talent and was quick to recommend him for events in the US and abroad. Another classical music commentator who endorsed Michael was the charismatic opera legend Franco Corelli, with whom Michael trained. Corelli stated many times that Michael has one of the finest tenor voices that he had ever heard. And then, of course, there's Tony Bennett. I suspect you know Tony Bennett. Tony Bennett is quoted as saying, "That's the most beautiful singing I've heard in years." Now we get to experience what Tony and all the others are so excited about. Please join me in welcoming Michael Amante.
Boy, that's a lot to live up to. Go ahead and roll on track one there. I'm gonna sing to you for the first song. It's actually an aria. This is from Puccini's wonderful opera, Tosca. It's a perfect opera. It's all about torture, murder, and suicide. So it's a happy tale. And my character, Cavalosi, is painting a Madonna, and he's comparing that Madonna to the ardent beauty of Tosca, who is madly in love with. This is called Recondita Armonia, from Act One, Tosca.
Maria.
is sung in the bel canto style, the Italian style of singing. You have to puff up really big to sing this. This is from a composer by the name of Joe Green. And if you speak Italian, that means Giuseppe Verdi. How nice it sounds. Joe Green, Giuseppe Verdi. There's a power to that. And this is from Rigoletto. It's a story about lust and murder and incest and horrible things, but it's a comedy. This is called La Donna Immobile from the third act of Rigoletto.
Turn to the science side of things. How many of you have had an MRI? Okay. You're not alone. Within the scope of medical diagnostics, about 100 million examinations are carried out with MRI around the world every year. If you do the math, that's about 3 MRI scans every second, okay? And none of this would be happening without the technology that was developed by Jens Frahm and his team at the Max Planck in Göttingen. Although people had recognized the potential for MRI imaging as a diagnostic tool, it was way too slow. Now, those of you, most of you had your hands up. You know what it's like sitting in the scanner and whatnot, okay? Not the most fun you've ever had. But without Jens' development, you would have had to sit in a scanner for at least 5 hours to get high-resolution imaging like we have today. Can you imagine? I mean, seriously. It was 1985 that his team invented Flash, which is fast, low angle shot MRI, which allowed for more than 100-fold reduction in the time that it takes to do MRI scanning. And it really emerged as one of the cornerstones of modern MRI. I am certain when you had your MRI done, it was using this technology. Now, the beauty of it is that Jens is still at it, okay? And his current advance marks another major breakthrough, Flash 2, which brings us close to real-time MRI. In other words, you're capable of looking inside the body and capturing it in action. I hope I didn't give too much away. Jens is director of biomedical NMR at the Max Planck Institute for Biophysical Chemistry in Göttingen, Germany. He has about 500 scientific publications, 5 patents. If I were to go through the list of awards, we'd be here, you know, for another half hour, I'm sure. But just some of the top ones. 2016, Hall of Fame of German Research. 2018, European Inventor Award. And 2020, just this year. In fact, he hasn't gotten it yet, but he's been measured for it. This is the most prestigious German technology prize, the Werner von Siemens ring. And so I'm told that he will have that later this year. So please join me in welcoming scientific director Jens Frahm.
Well, thank you very much, David, but you did it again, rising the expectation. Well, let me start with a question tonight. What do you think, wouldn't it be nice to see what Michael and Monty just did, to see so beautiful, to sing so beautiful? Perhaps we could even learn how to move the lips, the tongue, the velum, the glottis, all these articulators inside our oral cavity that determine this stream of air from the lung through the mouth to generate a sound wave reaching your ear, your brain. Well, honestly, a couple of years ago, I would have said totally impossible, at least with MRI. And nobody wants an X-ray movie. Well, for tonight, as just promised, I can report about a fantastic progress in magnetic resonance imaging, real-time MRI, which now offers access to arbitrary body motions, movements, physiological process, all kinds of dynamics that you can think of. We haven't even fully explored, and I can only give you a little glimpse tonight. And it really pushes MRI from photography to filming, or from anatomy to function. And yes, here is a singer.
Ich schnitt es gern in alle Rinden ein, ich trieb es gern in jeden Kieselstein. Ich möchte es sehen auf jedes frische Beet, mit Kressen, Blumen, die es schnell verrät. Auf jeden weißen Zettel möchte ich schreiben, dein ist mein Herz, dein ist mein Herz und soll es ewig, ewig bleiben.
It's so you see, for tonight, science directly meets music. And you will have more of that, I promise. Well, this technology offers unbelievable solutions and applications, new scientific, both scientific and medical applications. And let me start with some more examples. It turns out that these real-time MRI techniques nowadays are becoming a very important tool for studying phonetics. And in a clinical context, for example, to, for the very first time, look at stutterer. Try to identify what motor programs are going wrong and what happens in the mouth. Well, there are a couple of labs now around the world discussing this for different languages, asking different types of questions, such as very specific ones. For example, if you speak a vowel and there is a consonant in front or a following, how does this affect the vowel? And we just say Michael Armanti, but In German, it would be Michael Amante, which is a nasalation. And these issues can now be studied at great detail in all types of languages. I have a German example for natural speech here. It doesn't matter, you will appreciate the idea that we can actually identify all the articulators and all the different actions that are involved. And all I can say, I am so glad that I do not have to think voluntarily to move my tongue in a specific position in order to make me speak.
Dieser MRT-Tonfilm wurde mit 55 Bildern pro Sekunde gemessen. Man erkennt dabei Form- und Lageveränderungen des Zungenrückens, des Zungengrundes, des weichen Gaumens, des Kehldeckels und des Kehlkopfes. Achten Sie bitte auf diese Vorgänge bei den Vokalen A, E, I, O, U sowie bei den Konsonanten L, M, N, R, S, T, V, W, D, P, H.
What you can also recognize here is the tongue is just a muscle, and a muscle can be trained as any other muscle. And so if you have a singer or a professional speaker or an artist or a brass player, you see that the structure of the tongue actually follows your training. And what can be done with this particular muscle in extreme cases is shown on the right-hand side. It's not the audience for this type of music, I believe, but just look at the tongue.
Hello, my name is Timo Schnepp, aka Gaucho, and I'm going to perform the evolution of beatboxing inside a real live MRI. Here we go, fat boys!
From Cologne in Germany, quite an artist, and at least an artist as far as the tongue is concerned. Unbelievable. Well, let me briefly introduce into a second scientific program that we set up in Göttingen together with Peter Iltis from the Gordon College here in Wenham, Massachusetts. And this is about brass playing, and it has two major foci. One is pedagogy, to learn what brass musicians are actually doing, because they all teach without knowing what they are doing. And secondly, to better understand focal dystonia, embouchure dystonia, which affects 8 to 10% of all professional brass players throughout their life and their career. And often it's a devastating disease and a career terminating problem. So Peter Iltis is also head of the MRI Brass Repository project, where we show all these movies on the internet, making them freely available worldwide for teaching purposes. And these are coming from elite musicians, and we compare them and treat them as a database also to understand what happens in focal dystonia patients. Normally, like the articulatory stories that we just heard, we acquire these movies at 50 frames per second, 20 millisecond acquisition times per image. But in some cases, while playing these exercises at a slower speed, not the fastest possible staccato, for example, it's much more useful to have two films simultaneously. This mid-sagittal one, where you can see this, the position of the tongue from the side and then identify the gap to the soft palate and the velum here, and perpendicular at about this position where you see this little dark rim, a coronal view, which even better let us assume what kind of shape the tongue is taken in a perpendicular orientation and what the gap here is defined that controls the airstream from the lung to the mouth. And these are then at 2 times, 25 frames per second in an interleaf-frame-interleaf manner. And just watch and listen what kind of exercise we typically acquire. This is one of 30 different exercises. And it's a trombone. Nice, you see. To quantify these evaluations, and I show you an example how we are going to do this, because all this is completely new. We take the movies and take a frame of reference, which is set here, centered in the ground of the tongue, and then look at different positions, intensities as a function of time, and I only selected this one here, the central one, where we have the black zero signal, zero MRI signal here between the tongue and the soft palate, and then look at this series of images playing from very low pitch to very high pitch. And this stream of intensities as a function of time identifies what an elite musician is actually doing. He starts with an open gap here, wide open, with the full sound of a very low tone, and then increasingly gets smaller and smaller, but of course it has to remain open. And you can see also little dips whenever the musician is changing to a different note. What the dystonia patient does is the following. Starts at a much smaller gap in order to get the pressure together to accelerate the airstream to get the tone at all, and then shrinks the gap until nothing is any more possible. And he is actually not able to play the high notes. The point here, based on this comparison, is that in this most likely that in this particular patient, the muscular control of the tongue ground is lacking. And what you therefore, as a complement, do is use a physical trick, is accelerating by shrinking the gap. This is what happens in a stenosis in your blood vessel. When you have a partial occlusion, the rest of the blood flow is accelerated, which often causes the real serious problem because it damages the vascular wall. So Bernoulli effect, the physicists say, is the effect, and it holds true for fluid flow as well as for air streams. So this is how we try to learn to overcome these things and perhaps do some better training. There are standard mechanisms, but I'll show you something that really benefits from real-time MRI. Real-time MRI means we are not only acquiring very fast images, but we also immediately reconstruct and display the images with negligible latency on the scanner. But why, if we have it on the scanner, why can't we show it to the subject playing in the magnet at the same time so that he can control himself? And this is an example for a patient with tongue thrust from the Los Angeles Philharmonic Orchestra, actually, studied twice in Göttingen, with a difference of 1 year and 1 year of training in between, and nothing improved. It's a French horn player, and here we just test a single note, a medium-high C, C in the staff. And you can see what he's doing. Tracking the tongue would be correct, and then having the tongue tip down here. In order to create a big volume here in front, because that makes a good sound. Now, he was extremely disappointed after this second examination in Göttingen when we showed him what the other people are doing. Knowing what would be the best performance or the best or the standard behavior of the tongue for this particular sound and tone, he went back into the scanner and we showed him what he was doing so that he had visual feedback and visual control to try and get the proper tongue position. And here's the first result. Creeping back, but he's positive. And tip down. This was really exciting. This patient still has full neuromuscular control over positioning the tongue, which is very good news, which we couldn't know from just these standard procedures. And there may be a possibility of training. It's an expensive type of training, but we will have to explore any useful means. And this is also why we are seeking support for the MRI Brasser prototype project here. And if you are interested, just contact Peter Iltis. He's currently applying for an Emmy grant, actually. Now, I owe you an explanation. How can you play in a magnet? How can you play horn, trumpet, trombone? We have all these types of instruments available. Well, there are actually new textbooks already around. Eli Epstein here from the States used his own examination to write a new textbook, horn playing from the inside out. This really is science-informed music and perfectly fits to this lecture series here in Jupiter. But this is, on the right-hand side, Sarah Willis. She's from the Berlin Philharmonics and is one of the elite players in the program. And this is our original version, a normal bell flare, French horn. And here it's a plastic mouthpiece. And then we had some plastic tubing, correct length, correct diameter, in order to mimic the sound of a regular horn, without valves in this case. In the meantime, we have much better instruments. We have replaced the plastic tubing with the metallic tubing, specially arranged so that you can lie in the magnet and by a 90-degree angle feed out the sound. Now, fortunately, the German TV station did a recording of Sarah Willis' examination. I can show you a short piece out of that in order to explain how it is done.
Hey, Sarah. I think I'll take the horn for a moment and let you
know I'm going to show you the pathway, which you have to play through. Just try it.
How am I supposed to play for that?
I'm going to be in the MRI for about an hour, playing exercises which have been especially created for these tests.
Bye bye.
Are you ready? You say yes, and we'll start.
Synchronize and you'll see the big breath going in at the same time simultaneously.
Okay.
Yeah, yours is definitely
the tongue is huge.
It is. It takes up a lot of space. Diaphragm will rise, the liver will rise in this case.
Why is my tongue so far back?
You're retracting it? That's just how you're getting your sound. Pulsations with each note change, and as you go higher and higher, this area becomes smaller and smaller. So you're actually forming a channel with your tongue, the sides of your tongue on the palate, and then the roof of your mouth.
That's my tongue.
The eyes.
And on the low notes, there's a big orifice there, and as you get higher, it's just...
Yeah, the eyes.
Okay, I can just recommend, look at Zara Willis on the internet, and you find many, many episodes, other backstage visits to the Metropolitan Opera, a fancy new piano player, lots of very interesting episodes. Okay, I owe you a second explanation. Why is it possible? Why haven't we done it 25 years ago? Well, the problem is twofold, why MRI was or is slow. If you compare the raw data on the left-hand side with the corresponding image on the right-hand side, which can be transformed into each other both ways, then we have to acknowledge that the raw data is just a visual representation of 250 lines that had to be acquired individually in individual experiments. So it's not a single-shot photo, what we get in MRI, but it's a computational reconstruction from many, many data acquisitions. And in the early days, as mentioned by David, we also had to have long waiting times in between these individual acquisitions. So if you have 2 second waiting times, times 250 acquisitions that you need for a high resolution image, then it's 500 seconds, 7-8 minutes. For a cross-sectional, a 2D image, it would be 10 to 20 hours for a three-dimensional image. Now, to cut a long story short, we solved both problems. The lower ones here in 1985, by replacing a physical trick, or by using a physical trick to overcome a physical limitation where the whole industry believed it will never be done. Well, what people have done up to that point is for every single experiment, they use the entire available magnetization or the entire MRI signal. And if you do that, you have to wait for signal recovery. And that takes, indeed, by a physical, natural physics process, several seconds. So we invented a technique which can simply use only a small portion of the MRI signal, which then is used for spatially encoding and for acquiring one of these lines here. And that takes only a few milliseconds. So if you have enough signal left over, you can immediately continue without any waiting period. And that was the flash technique. And that actually made it to 3D MRI in minutes, cross-sectional imaging in seconds. This is a 3D acquisition. And then we had even faster processes in our bodies, such as the beating heart. And it allowed for the very first time to synchronize these rapid data acquisitions with the electrocardiogram, so that up to this point, up to date, cardiovascular MRI is used by ECG synchronized acquisitions, taking data from multiple heartbeats, merging them, resorting them together into a single synthetic cardiac cycle, which then is used for data evaluation for diagnostic purposes. That is true fake news, because it's not looking at the truly beating heart in its normal physiological condition. And this is one of the reasons why, after 25 years, we thought, well, we have to give it a new idea, a new trial. Well, so why was it still not fast enough? We solved one problem. What about the other? The only way to further speed up MRI was to replace many acquisitions by very few. Fortunately, we had tremendous progress in numerical mathematics in the meantime, solving so-called nonlinear inverse problems. I don't bother you with the details, but the simple idea is very easily graspable, namely why it's actually working when we take only 5% of the raw data, which makes it 20 times faster, and still get a nice reconstructed image. The point is And that's, I mean, everybody will come up to with this idea if you really think about the problem. The point is, we are not reconstructing a single image. Instead, we are reconstructing an image in the middle of a series of images. It's a film. If you look at an old analog film, then what you can see immediately is that every single frame very much looks like the previous one. So what we actually have to encode and reconstruct in simple words to make it plausible is only the difference. And the difference is very small if you have very high temporal resolution. There is an alternative, in the opposite direction method, where you don't wonder about the results. That's video streaming on a smartphone. Nobody is transferring the full image for a video stream. They only transfer the difference from frame to frame. Ours is a bit more complicated because we have to reconstruct and guess an image, which is done in iterative manner using these numerical mathematical tools, but it works. And as you can see here, this is now the first time that probably you see a truly beating heart. Whatever has been done in the past 30 years with ECG-gated synchronized acquisitions is not what is actually going on. I've selected this so-called bulbous view because you can nicely see that we have multiple heartbeats during free breathing, which is now, of course, improving the patient comfort during cardiac MRI. You can see the left ventricle, the bright blood in between, the stream of blood into the ascending aorta, and so on. So no waiting periods, extreme data undersampling, and a proper reconstruction, and we can have applications with up to 100 frames per second, which is our world record, 10 millisecond images. Let me show you a few examples which are of medical relevance in future. Cardiac MRI. Of course, we don't look at the bulbous view. We have to do long axis views, or the so-called four-chamber view, where this is the left ventricle, the right ventricle, and the left and right atrium. And then the so-called perpendicular view, short axis view, where you cut along this line here. And then you have this nice representation of the myocardial wall of the left ventricle in almost circular manner. You see the contraction during systole and the wall thickening, and this is actually what needs to be evaluated for diagnostic purposes. It's not the movie itself, it's all the functional parameters that you can get out of it. But this is now possible for every single heartbeat. And I can tell you they are all different, in particular during free breathing. Breath holding, which is typically required in current MRI exams of the heart, is changing the physiological condition. So here's such an example where we just measure for 20, 30, 40 seconds, and you can see during free breathing how different from heartbeat to heartbeat we have parameters such as the blood volume or the ejection fraction or the myocardial mass. The myocardial mass is high always when you have systolic contraction, and in that case the blood volume is the smallest one. This is actually one of these systolic frames here on the right-hand side. And it's a screenshot from a program that analyzes with new mathematics in a fully automatic manner hundreds of these cardiac images. It gives you new opportunities, and for example, to look at aperiodic motion, because this is an implicit assumption of ECG synchronized cardiac MRI that every single heartbeat is like any other. Which of course is not true, not even in healthy subjects. They are all different, differently long, for example, and this is a patient with atrial fibrillation done with the old and the new technique. And you can see, if you would, from such a poor image, which is only, as you can see, running down here, it's 25 images from a Sinner reconstruction, a synthetic cardiac cycle, if you would do functional analysis from these images, you would end up in a disaster. an area where radiologists are easily picking up the new tools, because this is a change of paradigm in general, which requires a change of paradigm on the clinical side, is pediatric radiology. Because you can drastically reduce the examination time and therefore the time for sedation, which is a very big issue. And this is a 3-year-old, even a 2-month-old. Normally in adult patients, you can study with 30 frames per second for picking up all the cardiac motions. Here at kids and infants, it's probably 50 frames per second
in this case. Now, an important component of cardiovascular MRI is measuring blood flow. And this is normally done in order to assess the output of the heart here at this position for the ascending aorta. The aorta goes up, bends over in an aortic arch, and then down close to the spinal cord. And this is shown here. This is not also possible in real time, because you have to acquire 2 data sets with and without flow compensation. It's even more of a problem, but with this high degree of understanding, you can just cope with that. And again, at 30 frames per second, get both images, an anatomical movie and a velocity movie, where here the direction is indicated by bright or dark. In the ascending aorta, the blood is flowing upwards, and then in the descending downwards to support the lower portions of the body, and the intensities are directly related to velocity. And I have one more of these new experiments where we now have access to online physiology. While the patient is in the magnet, you can perform simple tasks, simple stress tests, a hand grip or breathing maneuver, as in this case, where we ask the subject for 10 seconds to perform a so-called Valsalva maneuver, which is breath holding and putting some pressure on the upper thorax, so that the heart is challenged because it has to pump against this pressure. And what happens is, this is textbook results, the velocity, which normally is about 1 meter per second in the ascending aorta, goes down by a factor of 2. And the output of the cardiac function is going down by a factor of 4, from 6 to less than 1.5 liters per minute. Why? Because due to the pressure, not only the velocity is down, but also the lumen, the diameter of the aorta, is down by a certain amount. And so you're pumping much less blood into your body. But there's a time course coming in with it. There is a specific time course for the recovery after releasing the pressure. And all these may become completely new parameters for diagnostic purpose, often in suspected patients which are still asymptomatic. Let me add a little more, coming back to the brain and neuroscience. Since we can now, without any prejudice, meaning without ECG synchronization, because if you put periodicity in your acquisition, you get periodicity out. But without that prejudice, we can now have a look at the brain. And here's a coronal scan, and you can see there is action. There's something happening here. This is the lateral ventricles, both. This is the third ventricle. There is CSF, cerebrospinal fluid, moving through this position. We were actually looking for this at a much higher rate, because people claim this passive CSF flow is regulated by arterial pulsation of neighboring arteries. Then it would be this in real time here, this movie. So then it would be every second going up and down. Completely wrong. It's not. The major regulator for CSF flow, human CSF flow, is respiration. And then, after discovering this online, we forced our subjects to perform a breathing protocol to identify the actual performance. And whenever you inspire, you get strong CSF flow here through the third ventricle.
In fact, it's a bit more complicated. In the meantime, we've done these previous velocity mapping, where you know the direction and the exact velocity, also for CSF flow, in, along the entire spinal cord and in these various portions of the brain. And it turns out that when you inspire, you lower the pressure in your upper thorax, and as a consequence, the passive venous blood comes out of the brain, because it must be turned back to the heart. But as a compensatory mechanism, the CSF in the spinal cord moves upwards into the brain. And that's really a very important discovery with clinical relationships to hydrocephalus. Even astronauts are affected by that, because under zero gravity, you don't have this kind of pressure. So we are in contact with these people, the medical people around. Now, let me show you a musical example, because that, instead of a nasty breathing protocol here, tells you exactly the same. Because we are bringing our CSF into movement all the time while moving during normal behavior. And this is very important, this dynamic movement, as the CSF is the important aspect for clearing waste products from the neurons out of our brain. Without that, you face problems. And there are many speculations that even contributions to Alzheimer's disease might be responsible as this disturbed CSF dynamics. Now, we look in the neck region, in the cervical spine, at the CSF flow during grass play. So this is the neck region. Here we have the anatomical movie and the velocity movie. And at the start, we don't see anything. But here's the spinal cord, and it's surrounded by CSF. And here will occur the CSF ring. Whenever it's flowing upwards, it's getting bright. And after that, it's getting, during exhalation, it's getting dark. So when you hear the music, you will experience, you will automatically know when the subject is breathing in and out. And then let's see how it behaves during Brahms symphony movement form. Look on this side. Now the subject will breathe in, out. Now again, in. As well. And I'll show you one example, because people are always asking, real-time MRI is a cross-sectional imaging technique, just a single slice. But wouldn't it be nice to cover volume? Because in many clinical situations, you need to cover the entire brain, the entire liver, the prostate, or whatever. And yes, we can, without any change to the technical algorithm. Because it's working, and this is why I explained it a bit longer some minutes ago, it's working because we exploit the similarity of neighboring or successive images. But this similarity exists not only in time, with very few changes from frame to frame, but also in space, if you have a neighboring or even overlapping section. So what we are now doing is real-time MRI of a cross-section. On every single frame, let's say every 50 milliseconds, we move the section automatically in the scanner by a certain percentage of the slice thickness, for example, 1 millimeter or 2. So what you can do at that speed, 3 centimeters per second, cover a volume, and a brain may be done in 5 seconds. And this is one of the first examples. with a typical T2 weighted type of contrast which is preferred by the clinicians. This is a brain scan in 5 seconds. Again, pediatric radiology loves it because they can just hold without any sedation an infant for testing for gross structural abnormalities. The funny thing, even if the subject is moving in between, this doesn't hurt because we have 50 millisecond frames. It may actually shift the actual frame, but the reconstruction will be possible and give you a clean and decent image. So we can use this volume coverage technique throughout the entire body, not just in the non-moving brain. And this is very important, and here we start in the region of the heart, go down the entire liver, pancreas, which is normally very difficult to see in MRI. Just this is, I believe, a 6-second scan.
You can even do this repetitively, every 5, every 6 seconds, or whatsoever, during the application of a contrast agent, and then assess perfusion effects as the contrast agent reaches the entire volume, and you don't miss anything. And of course, it's very important for doing this on the prostate, where this is one of the current techniques. And here's a 4-second scan of the entire prostate. Well, there are 2 variants of this. Here we are automatically advancing by computer-controlled manners the slice position. But you can also use this real-time MRI technique to manually move the position of your section through the body. And this will be done for visual monitoring of minimally invasive interventions, such as setting a biopsy, taking a biopsy, or setting a catheter for a radio frequency ablation, or things like that. You can actually follow manually with your slice position and get a stream of images. And there is the other way around. Instead of moving the slice, we can fix the slice in the middle of the magnet and move the patient. And this is a pilot experiment where we start at the legs, and you can see, depending on the height of the person, you get a whole body scan. This is at 5 centimeters per second in 30, 40 seconds. Very preliminary. It's a proof of principle study only done very recently, but it's actually indicating what might come in the future of MRI. But now I think it's really time to come back to music. And so I will close by another principal French horn player from the Berlin Philharmonics, a world-class musician who played for us in the Scanner in Göttingen, like Sarah Willis also. And since this 2020 is the 250th birthday of Beethoven, we will hear the famous French horn solo from the Eroica. Thank you very much.
Thanks for having me back. I'll try to make this as scientific as possible. I'd like to sing this next song in what's called legit singing. If you're a Broadway person or in New York, this is called legit. It's a blend of different voicings. Start with the mouth, which is also called mezzo voce, and in the throat, and really big, that's also called belting. Soft palate behind the nose, that sometimes that's called a head voice. Everything is really a head voice. You can't resonate backwards. Everything is up in the head. But just making little changes in your throat and in your brain, it goes to different places and helps you to sing either high or low. So this comes from us, from the songwriting team of Harold Arlen and Yip Halberg. I don't know if you know who those people are, but they wrote a beautiful song called Over the Rainbow. So it was a lot. Somewhere over the rainbow. All right, now we're going to really change the voice a little bit. We're going to soften it up even more seductive as much as possible. Even softer, more in the mouth, more far forward. Just kind of chewing on the sound a little bit. This is a little love song, so if you're hearing that special someone, even if you don't know who they are, just crack it.
From Giacomo Puccini, a wonderful aria that
Nessun Dorma from Turin.
Science and amazing music, all right? We look forward to seeing you back here April 1st, okay, for another Science Meets Music. Take care.